Hello, I'm John Cork, producer of special features for this release of the Charlie Chan films on DVD. We're presenting this audio play version of a Charlie Chan mystery for one simple reason. The original film no longer exists. All in all, there are four lost Chan films. Charlie Chan Carries On, which is Warner Oland's first appearance as Chan. Charlie Chan's Chance, Charlie Chan's Greatest Case, and Charlie Chan's Courage. What survives are the original screenplays. How do four films, which were successfully released around the globe, become lost? First, it's important to understand that the film studios did not have multiple formats on which to store the films. They only had film itself. Video didn't exist. Yet film studios did seek to take multiple copies of their films and store them in multiple locations, and in its own way, that may have led to the disappearance of some films. Someone, an employee, may have discarded a film that they felt may have been damaged for some reason, believing there to be another copy in another location. A copy may have been borrowed by an employee to show to a friend and never returned, again believing there might be a backup in another location. Of course, the prints that were struck for movie theaters were often destroyed shortly after they began being distributed because they would become worn or damaged. Two fires are most likely responsible for the disappearance of this film. The first occurred in Little Ferry, New Jersey in 1937, and in that fire, the original negative to many of the early Charlie Chan films were lost. The second fire occurred in Ogdensburg, New Jersey in 1952, and it's believed that all remaining copies of this film disappeared in that fire. What you're about to hear is a recording of the screenplay by Philip Klein and Barry Connors, adapted from the novel by Earl Derr Biggers, recorded in 2007 with some slight adaptations for audio presentation. The photos that you're about to see and the illustrations come from the still archives at 20th Century Fox Studios. The film was originally released in 1932, filmed in 1931. We hope you enjoy this window into Charlie Chan's past. Thank you.
Our story begins at the Bureau of Criminal Investigation in the offices of the New York Police Department. It is a collection of fine, hard-working men of law enforcement and some of the worst members of society.
Come on, give us the other one. Come on, come on. Put it in there. Afraid to get it dirty? What's the matter? You've done this before. This is nothing new to you. Nothing strange about it, okay?
File cabinets filled with the records of criminals line the room as Inspector Flannery gives a tour to two very special visitors. Inspector Fife of Scotland Yard and the great detective from Hawaii, Mr. Charlie Chan.
This here is our rogues gallery. I'm willing to bet your police department in Honolulu hasn't any collection like this, has it, Mr. Chan?
Not so many. The islands are not yet so civilized as New York. Inspector Fife perhaps has as many in Scotland Yard?
Yes, unfortunately the British Islands are also more civilized than the Hawaiian.
Here's a man who's hard to arrest. Always has to be clubbed into submission. He's what we call a hard nut.
Hard nut?
Yeah, hard nut.
Oh, I see. Some heads like hard nuts, much better if well cracked.
Right. Gentlemen, I want you to see the lineup. These criminals are more interesting in the flesh.
The men enter the police department's main auditorium, where the show is nothing like the one seen on Broadway. And the backdrop is a series of lines marking the height of the actors in the city's most sordid dramas. Flannery walks up onto the platform to address the audience of police officers waiting in their seats. Charlie Chan and Inspector Fife stand nearby.
Boys, this gentleman is Inspector Fife of Scotland Yard. And this gentleman is Inspector Chan of the Honolulu Police, who's been sent here to study New York police methods. Now, we've heard of Sherlock Holmes, Arsene Lupin, and now we have with us one equally known, Charlie Chan. And those boys are what I consider one of the finest detective organizations in the world.
Could not be otherwise. Under strong general, there are no weak soldiers.
Ready with the lineup?
All ready, Inspector. John Hawkins. Hawkins, stand on the platform. Look straight out in front of you. Take your hat off.
Last night in Washington Heights, he put a man to sleep with a blackjack. Kicked all his teeth out and robbed him of $50. What do you do for a living?
I'm a dentist.
Dentist, eh? And you use a blackjack instead of gas? Some idea. Take him off.
Isidore Rosenblatt. Put your hat on. Look straight to the front.
This man is charged with entering a delicatessen on 116th Street and stealing a ham. How'd you come to steal a ham?
You're Inspector Flannery, ain't you?
Never mind my name. Why'd you do it?
Well, I'll tell you the truth, Inspector. I took that ham for a poor starving Irish family named Flannery.
Take him out.
Step down off the platform. Evelyn Vandeleer.
Ms. Vandeleer, look straight out in front of you. Now, this girl is charged with blackmailing a man out of
$800. $800? Say, that 30-cent millionaire was just $8 short of having 20 cents. So wipe your nose on that one.
This young lady is what we call a live wire. Right.
Take her off. The Raja Mangapur. Look straight ahead of you and take that steeple off.
This man claims to be the seventh son of the seventh son, born with a veil. He's charged with fortune-telling and swindling. What have you to say for yourself?
I'm no fortune-teller, Your Honor. I predict the future events by virtue of the science of astrology.
Come on out from behind those whiskers, Benny. Gentlemen, this is Benny the Dip. He used to imagine he was a pickpocket, but he couldn't get his hand in and out of a sugar barrel.
Go on. I'm better than anyone you ever knocked off.
Well, you better consult the stars and find out how long it will be before you get out.
Oh, yes.
Take him off.
Step down. Put that hat on.
Well, gentlemen, I suppose you two have had enough of this.
It's been very interesting, Inspector. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Come on, Charlie.
After a day of learning New York police procedures, Charlie Chan, Inspector Fife, and Inspector Flannery visit Manhattan's famous Chinatown and the Key Lin restaurant.
You have heard the story about the mule who tried to come down from the attic on a ladder?
What is that?
I will tell you later.
Well, come on, Charlie, we must be going. Thank you, Key Lin, for a most enjoyable dinner.
When your feet enter my humble dwelling, I am honored more than I deserve.
That's very nice of you.
Good kitchens kill more men than sharp swords.
Telephone. Hi. Hello? Mr. Chan?
Hello? What? Oh, yes. Inspector Fife is here. Okay, one moment.
Thank you, Charlie. Yes. How long ago? Oh, this is terrible. Very well, I'll be there as soon as possible.
Something has happened?
Sir Lionel Gray, former chief of Scotland Yard, has just dropped dead in Barry Kirk's office in Wall Street.
So sorry. Can I be of service?
Yes, come with me, Charlie, will you? I'm afraid we must go, Keelan. Good night.
May blessings come and sit on your doorstep. Homan.
Homan.
Good night to you.
It is an hour later. We are now in the offices of successful businessman Barry Kirk. Dr. Hammond completes his inspection of the body.
Unquestionably, gentlemen, a case of heart failure, I should say. Sir Lionel has been dead over an hour.
Thank you, Dr. Hammond. Well, he died in the line of duty. Although retired, he was still investigating unsolved cases.
These are your offices, Mr. Kirk?
Yes, I turned them over to Sir Lionel, and he's been stopping with me in my penthouse upstairs.
Did he complain of illness?
On the contrary, he was in fine spirits. Said he was on the verge of solving an important case.
Did he name case?
No. He asked me to invite several guests here tonight. They're upstairs right now. Then, unexpectedly, someone telephoned him for an appointment here.
Who?
He gave his name. I don't recall it. However, after Sir Lionel had been absent an hour, I sent my butler down and he found him as you see him.
You are positive, Honorable Sir, this man died of heart failure.
Positive, sir. I would stake my professional reputation on it.
But who or what stopped heart?
What do you mean, Charlie?
I've seen strange thing in this room.
What?
House cat has not moved or taken breath since we came.
Cat? Why? Where?
Under that chair. Dead.
Is that your cat, Mr. Kirk?
Yes.
When did you last see it?
Upstairs, just before dinner.
That's strange.
Very strange. Cat is like rich man's heir, never dies out of sympathy.
Well, you don't think there's a connection?
Prominent detective is about to catch criminal. At this point, detective is found dead.
That may be mere coincidence, Charlie.
I always suspect coincidence. Same as gnomes always suspect ancient cheese.
You really think?
Yes. Hold guests upstairs. Telephone Inspector Flannery. This is murder.
It is later that evening. In Kirk's penthouse, Inspector Flannery has now joined the others in the living room along with the party guests. The inspector is in the midst of questioning Paradise, Barry Kirk's butler.
Well, go on. What happened then?
Why, sir, Mr. Kirk sent me below for Sir Lionel, and I found the office door and window open, and a breeze blowing all the papers about, sir. So I closed the windows, went into the private office, and there, sir, I found Sir Lionel.
Haven't I seen you before somewhere?
I think not, sir.
If anyone could throw any light on this affair, I'd like it shed right now. It will be much pleasanter all round than if I have to dig it up later. Miss Garland, you say you're an actress.
Yes, and a lot of others have said it too.
I'll take your word for it. Ever played England?
Yes, often.
Have you ever met Sir Lionel before tonight, Miss Garland?
Never.
What time did you arrive here for dinner?
I had intended arriving at 8, but coming up the stairs, I broke my string of pearls, and I spent about 20 minutes picking them up, making sure I hadn't lost any.
I see.
Mr. Enderby, Sir Lionel was evidently looking for an Englishman. You were born in England, weren't you?
Is that an offense?
Garrett, please, he's not accusing you of anything.
Bah! I don't like this questioning. Are we suspects?
Every guest here had the opportunity during that bridge game after dinner to leave this room. Did you?
No, I didn't.
Oh, but Garrick, you...
Bah! Must you contradict? What were you going to say?
Nothing.
But you left the room just after we lost the third rubber, didn't you?
You're quite mistaken, Dunwood. I haven't left this room this evening.
Huh. My error. Sorry.
Sorry. Bah!
And you, Mr. Dunwood?
Oh, yes, I was out quite a while, in the garden, admiring the skyline.
Hello. Barry Kirk here. I can vouch for Mr. Dunwood. I brought him out a drink.
Oh, but I didn't drink it, Inspector.
My error. I shouldn't have mentioned it before the Inspector. Sorry.
Was it a good drink, Mr. Dunwood?
Excellent.
How do you know it was?
You have me there.
You're an Englishman too, aren't you?
Australian. Educated in London and Heidelberg.
And your offices are in this building?
Mr. Dunwood was my first important tenant. That's how we became friends. Now he attends to all my investments.
Anything else I can help you with, Inspector?
No, sir. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. I'll not keep you any longer. Let's look around, boys.
Inspector Flannery exits the living room and addresses his men outside the room, Charlie Chan and Inspector Fife following closely behind.
All right, boys. Report to headquarters.
Okay, Chief.
Up on the roof of the penthouse, Charlie Chan, Inspector Fife, and Inspector Flannery gather at the parapet, looking over.
There's our financial district, Charlie. That's the battery down there. Those lights you see, well, that's the Brooklyn Bridge.
I must see it in daytime.
I wonder who made that telephone appointment with Sir Lionel.
He was interested in one of these guests. Which one?
I've seen that butler in the prisoner's dock in England somewhere.
Yes?
Yes. Scotland Yard will have the record. What do you think of Enderby?
Enderby? Oh, he reminds me of Little Lamb.
What?
Every few seconds he says, bah, bah.
Very rude to his wife, wasn't he?
Maybe some people on Sea of Matrimony wish they had missed boat.
Mr. Kirk, I wish you could remember the name of the man who made that telephone appointment.
It was John something. I'm sure I'd recognize it if I heard it again.
Inspector Flannery, I wonder if your men have found any fingerprints.
I'm going down to see.
Is possible for any of the party to have gone downstairs to offices below?
Yes, it is.
Let us go down.
In Kirk's office, policemen work gathering clues. Two men are photographing fingerprints.
Any prints?
Yes, sir. About 10 of them. They look very good, too.
Yes. Someone stood here with his fingers on the desk facing Sir Lionel. Shoot them down to headquarters for classification.
Yes, sir.
Operator, I want you to get me Spring 73100.
Mr. Kirk, did Sir Lionel keep papers in this safe?
Yes.
Open, please.
Flannery speaking. Give me the lieutenant. Lieutenant, I want you to trace all calls made on Hanover 27700 in the last 24 hours.
Why, that's odd. He must have removed the papers.
Perhaps person who removed him also removed papers. What is this?
That's the membership book to the Cosmopolitan Club. And that card, I procured a 2 weeks guest card for Sir Lionel.
Know any of these names?
No.
We find the safe has been robbed of all Sir Lionel's papers.
There's your motive, gentlemen.
Undoubtedly.
I think the autopsy will show he was killed with gas.
An almost perfect crime. Doctor, extremely positive verdict was heart failure.
Yes, and we would have believed him, but thanks to you, Charlie.
No, thanks to Honorable Cat. Inspector Flannery, on this Cosmopolitan Club membership card, his number written, 1313. You think this means something?
I don't think so.
Sometimes very small cloud hides sun.
Hello? Yes. Yes? What's the number? How's the telephone listed? What name? John R. Douglas.
That's the name. John R. Douglas.
Well, what's the address? Well, what's his business? Right. Right. Gentlemen, guess what this man's business is.
What?
He's a manufacturer of chemicals. It fits, doesn't it?
Yes. Like duck's foot in mud pond.
Well, I think we're after the right man. I'll give you a ring as soon as we pick him up.
Quick work, what? He's what you Americans call a hot shot.
Chef who cooks with gunpowder make quick fire.
Well, gentlemen, may I offer you a drink?
No, thanks. On subject of drink, I am one round prize fighter. Second round, always knockout.
I hope Flannery is after the right man.
I think I'll telephone Scotland Yard. Will you get it for me, Mr. Kirk?
Certainly.
Thank you.
Hello, get me transatlantic operator, please. I want to speak to Scotland Yard, London, England. Hanover 27700.
Across the Atlantic, a young girl on a switchboard answers the radio call.
This is London. I'll put you through to Scotland Yard.
Hello, are you there? Yes, this is Scotland Yard. Oh, he's New York on the telephone, sir.
Thank you. Hello.
Yes, I'm sorry to report. Sir Lionel Gray was murdered here tonight.
Oh, terrible.
Please cable me immediately, in code, the name of the case in which he was interested and the full details. Also, complete data on a man named Stanley Paradise.
Aye, you shall have it forthwith.
Thank you.
Are you investigating my butler?
Merely a matter of routine, Mr. Kirk.
Oh, well. Gentlemen, I'll see you upstairs.
Strange lack of clues, Charlie.
Remember, nothing but the wind can pass the sun without casting shadows.
Let's take a look in here. Charlie, I'm going to make an important inquiry.
Yes?
You've solved some extraordinary cases. I wish I could make you stay and help me.
You forget, there's new baby in our family in Honolulu.
No, I don't. It's a boy, isn't it?
Oh yes, a boy. Most fortunate. Out of 11 opportunities, I've been unfortunate 3 times.
Well, that's splendid.
Well, I must send cable. Baby will have to wait a while to see old Papa.
You mean you'll stay, Charlie?
When friend asks, friend gives.
That is splendid. Thank you, Charlie. You can write your cable here at the desk.
Charlie Chan picks up a pen to write a cable to his wife and family, but when he tries to ink the nib...
Oh, something in inkwell. Pearl from string.
The broken necklace.
In another part of the city, at a roadhouse cafe, a taxicab pulls up to the entrance and Shirley Marlowe gets out.
How do you do, ma'am?
Miss Shirley Marlowe, here to meet Mr. John R. Douglas.
Oh, yes, ma'am. This way, please. Here's the lady, sir.
Hello, Shirley.
Hello, John. Am I late?
No. You must have hurried.
Oh, I did.
Supper, sir?
Supper?
Oh, no, thank you. Nothing to eat. Just coffee.
The same for me, please.
Yes, sir.
You know,
I had a feeling I was being followed.
So did I.
You did? Did you see Sir Lionel?
Yes, but it wasn't easy.
He didn't refuse to see you.
Oh, no, no. He was attending a bridge party in Barry Kirk's penthouse, and I was obliged to wait in the office below. He seemed surprised when he found out I'd come from you. Tried to trick me into telling him where you lived and your name.
But you didn't.
Of course not. I told him I wouldn't, unless he promised to protect you. But he refused to compromise.
What will he do?
He said if you didn't tell him where Alan Raleigh is and testify against him, he'd find you. Take you back to England and try you as an accessory after the fact for shielding a murderer.
Your coffee? Cream sugar?
Just leave them on the table, thanks. I pleaded with him. Told him he was heaping tragedy on a girl who had suffered too much already. But he's an iceberg.
But didn't you tell him that I don't know where Alan is? That I'd never seen him since that night in London?
He doesn't believe it. I told him he was asking too much of you, of any girl, to send a man she once loved to a hangman.
Couldn't he understand that?
He agreed to think it over. He told me to come back tomorrow afternoon at 3 o'clock.
Maybe he said that so he could have you followed and find me.
In that case, I'd better not see him again. Here, have some coffee.
I don't think I even want coffee, John. Do you mind taking me home?
Of course not. Check, please.
A short while later, John Douglas's car pulls up outside Shirley's apartment house and parks in front of the building.
Shirley, dear. Good night, dear. Think it over. Marry me, and we'll go away together.
Oh, I'd like to. I love you better than anything else in the world. But don't ask me to decide now. Good night, dear.
At a nearby filling station, Inspector Flannery stands with the attendant. A newsboy walks by them.
Extra! All about the Wall Street murder! All about the Wall Street murder! Extra! Paper!
Here, boy. Here. Let me have one of those.
Paper, sir? Here he is.
As Inspector Flannery buys the paper, another car drives into the gas station. The car of John R. Douglas.
Thank you. Paper! Paper! All about the Wall Street murder! Paper! Extra! Extra! Evening Journal! All about the Wall Street murder!
Hey, attendant! Hey!
You John R. Douglas?
Why, yes.
Inspector Flannery, come on. Get out on this side.
What for?
Ride down to headquarters.
Why?
Take a look at those headlines.
I don't believe it!
In the office of Barry Kirk, Inspector Flannery enters and is met by Inspector Fife and Charlie Chan.
The autopsy showed no signs of poisoning in the stomach, but the lungs showed gas.
Has Douglas decided to talk yet?
He denies he was here last night, but the fingerprints we found on the desk are his.
What about the elevator boy?
Identified Douglas positively as the man he brought up and took down just about the time of the murder. When we proved Douglas was lying, he shut up like a clam.
Well, this looks rather bad for him.
He's guilty. If he isn't, why does he lie? Why is he afraid to talk?
Silence is golden, except in police station.
I'm gonna go down and give him another grilling. Where can I reach you?
We're staying here. Mr. Kirk insisted on our being his guests during the investigation.
We? Charlie, I thought you were on your way to Honolulu.
No, Mr. Chan has kindly consented to stay.
Oh, think we need help, Charlie?
Inspector Fife. I want to go home and meet new boy.
Do you mean to say I have the wrong man?
Can happen. Even wise flies sometimes mistake spiderweb for old man's whiskers.
Well, I hope you dig up something. It sometimes takes two heads to.
Also takes two heads to make empty barrel.
See you later.
Charlie, tell me, why do you pay so much?
Notice approaching shadow on frosted glass of door.
Hold on here. Paradise.
Pardon, sir. I was just about to knock. A letter addressed to Sir Lionel. And Miss Garland's waiting upstairs, sir.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
From Scotland Yard to Thomas Cook and Sons.
Is not Garrick Enderby with Cook and Son?
Yes. a blank sheet of paper. Charlie, this envelope has been steamed and resealed.
And whoever did this forgot to cleanse his hands.
Why?
There's one fine thumbprint.
Show me. I'm going to try and match that thumbprint at Thomas Cook & Sons. Charlie, I'll get you to interview Miss Garland for me, will you?
Me?
Yes.
A few moments later, we are in the penthouse apartment of Barry Kirk. Kenneth Dunwood and Gloria wait in the main living room.
Well, I'll leave you to the tender mercies of the police.
Stay here with me. I'm frightened.
Great Scott, you don't know anything to tell them, do you?
No.
Well, in that case, speak freely. Kirk's waiting for me. I'll see you later.
May I bring you something to drink while you're waiting, Miss Garland?
No. Thank you, Paradise.
Good morning, Miss Garland. Inspector Fife appointed me unworthy substitute.
I told Inspector Flannery everything I know about this last night.
Humbly begging pardon. I'm in great hurry. How did this pearl from your broken string mix itself with ink on Sir Lionel's desk?
It isn't mine.
Do not tangle foot on fringe of murder.
Go away!
Only foolish mouse plays with cat. Were you in Sir Lionel's office last night before he died or after?
Wait. I'll tell you everything. He stopped me as I passed the office on my way up here. He told me he had asked Mr. Kirk to invite him here for a special request.
And that reason was?
He asked me about a girl who disappeared from a show 4 years ago in London. A girl I played with. He wanted to know if I'd seen her in New York. I told him no.
Why did you tell him no?
We were dear friends. She's a lovely girl. I was afraid I might get her into some trouble.
Where can I find her? What is her name?
She's known as the Masked Dancer at the Follies.
The Masked Dancer at the Follies. Paradise, my hat. Oh, pardon haste. Thank you so much. Oh, your pearl.
Is that all you want to know? Just that one thing?
One at a time is good fishing.
It is the end of the performance of the Masked Dancer at the Follies, a woman whose beauty and talent draw crowds every night. But backstage, her identity remains hidden. She wears her mask even in her dressing room with her maid.
Yeah, that's her room, number one, right up there.
Thank you so much.
Tanya, dear, see who it is for me.
Oui, mademoiselle. May I help you?
Will you give card to a lady, please?
Oui, monsieur.
As Charlie Chan stands by the door, a group of chorus girls pass him on their way to the dressing rooms. Charlie Chan watches them in their scanty costumes.
What a chop suey!
No laundry today.
So I notice.
Can you see mademoiselle after the matinee, sir?
Tell her I'm afraid person Sir Lionel's sword may disappear again.
Ask him to come in. Tanya, dear, would you wait outside, please?
I must ask you please to remove mask.
I always wear it to and from the theater and while I'm here.
Also, perhaps to avoid recognition?
You want the mask off? Well?
You look like a nice girl. You have not been happy since that night in London 4 years ago when you disappear.
You're making sure I'll never be happy again, aren't you?
I only seek truth. A man has been arrested and charged with murder. I do not believe he's guilty.
He isn't. He's innocent. Why, he didn't even know Sir Lionel was dead. He was going back this afternoon to see him.
You knew he was there then?
He went to Sir Lionel to plead for me.
He is shielding you. That is why he will not talk. May I take a seat?
Of course.
Now, tell me...
You'll only use what I tell you against me.
You forget police are also human beings. You can trust me.
Well, I was in love with Alan Raleigh. We were to be married. I was young, infatuated. The day after his aunt's death, I discovered he was guilty of the crime.
That is why you disappeared.
Oh, I had loved him. I couldn't give him up to justice. But ever since, I've been haunted.
hunted as if I myself were guilty.
Did you go with him?
No. I've never seen him since that day in London. But I think he's in New York.
Why?
I've seen his Chinese servant here.
Do you remember name of servant?
In London, he was called Li Gong.
Li Gong. Li Gong.
What will they do to John?
You are much interested in him.
Oh, he must be freed. If necessary, I'll tell them everything. I'll even let them take me back and try me.
No, no. More important to find Alan Riley. For present, keep secret. I will keep also, like good friend.
Oh, I need a friend. John and I both need a friend, desperately.
I will try to be that friend.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Chan. I'm sure you can help us.
I'm only an insignificant, clumsy person, and it is difficult to pick up needle with boxing glove.
Back at the Chinese restaurant of Key Lin, Charlie Chan and Key Lin are seated together.
No matter how great the difficulty, fortune always leaves an open door through which can come remedy.
You encourage me, honorable friend.
Tell me, how can I help you?
Oh, you have done so already. Friends like fiddlestrings should not be stretched too tight.
Ask.
I seek a man named Li Gong. Where can I find him, wise one?
Li Gong. On Li Street, number 1313, there is a man called Henry Li. He has a cousin, Li Gong, who sometime come to visit him.
1313. And this Li Gong, what is known of him?
Very little, except he once lived in Limehouse, London.
Limehouse, London. Out of the darkness of the unknown comes bright spark of light. My humble gratitude is yours. Duty says I must walk my way.
Joy Kin.
Joy Kin.
Charlie Chan travels to the apartment house of Li Gong. Charlie Chan pauses by a door and listens. He begins up the next flight of stairs till he reaches the corner. Then, the great detective does a curious thing. He turns and stumbles down the steps till he comes to rest at the door, holding his ankle in pain.
Ah! Ow!
What's the matter? Did you hurt yourself?
I've given my ankle a bad turn. If only I could rest a little.
Sure. Here, let me help you. Come on. My name's Henry. Henry Li. My uncle can help you. Say, uncle, this gentleman hurt himself.
Condescend to enter my contemptible abode.
Thank you.
I go get my first aid kit.
Oh, injury not serious enough for first aid kit.
But every day, Boy Scout have to do one good deed.
Every day, one good deed. Nice boy. Accident overwhelmed me while in search of my old friend, Li Gong.
You are a friend of Li Gong?
Henry Lee's uncle looks toward a photograph on the table. Charlie Chan looks in the same direction. The photograph is of a Chinese man in European clothes.
Yes, that is excellent likeness of him.
Yes, he was here this morning.
Where can I find him?
He disappeared on business of his own.
He still works for same Englishman?
My cousin speaks little of his affairs.
Probably why he is so valuable to his employer.
Here's Dr. Bloom. He's got a first aid kit.
An accident. Which one of you?
This man's ankle.
Oh.
But I don't need a doctor. It is not serious.
Well, all sprains are serious. It's a good thing you sent for me in time. Now, let's get this sock off.
But I did not send for you.
No, I did. That's my good deed for today.
Hey, what's the idea? There's nothing wrong with this ankle.
I told you it was nothing.
$5, please.
Have only 10. Change, please.
Well, here you are. Thank you. Good day. Good day, sir.
A fool and his money never become old acquaintances.
So I observe.
These doctors. $5 for this. What would he charge for a broken neck?
Here's your hat.
Oh, I see. Guess who lingers too long becomes stale like unused fish.
You are a second man who has come here for Li Gong.
Yes?
The other was Englishman. Did I not read in paper of his death?
Possibly.
If you'll accept humble advice, step carefully. Rain quenches unguarded fire.
Ah, yes. But it takes very rainy day to drown duck.
Hey, mister! You forgot your sock.
Thank you so much. And every day when you are doing kind deed, remember kind-hearted elephant who tried to help hen hatch chickens.
What did he do?
He sat down on hen's eggs.
I got you.
Back at the office of Barry Kirk?
But Inspector Fife, if the police found several gas masks in Douglas Chemical Factory, why advertise? Why offer a reward?
They haven't found the gas mask, Dunwood.
There are gas masks to be found in every chemical factory, Mr. Dunwood. It doesn't necessarily mean that Mr. Douglas committed the murder. Isn't that right, Mr. Kirk?
Yes, sir.
Will you be so kind as to place the ad I've written?
I'll see that it goes in all the morning and evening papers.
All right, mate, but I don't think it'll bring any results. It looks like a slim chance. Ah, Charlie.
Hello, Inspector Fife. Mr. Kirk? Mr. Dunwood?
Well, Charlie, I'll wager you've been busy. Oh,
busy as one-eyed cat watching six mouse holes.
Did you find anything?
My day's work has been as useless as life preserver for fish.
Too bad. Anything happened after you telephoned? What about Lee Gung?
Boy Scout perpetrated good deed in up-dumped apple cart.
I'll attend to the ad. We'll be on our way. Oh, Inspector Fife, you got the cable?
Yes, Mr. Kirk, thank you. Well, cheerio. Better luck another day.
Good day, Mr. Dunwood. Inspector Fife, what did you find at Cook and Sons?
Charlie, the thumbprint on this blank sheet of paper is not Enderby's.
No?
No. Here's a photograph of it. Someone else was opening Sir Lionel's mail.
Paradise enters with the tray. Charlie Chan watches the butler as he brings the tray over to the desk.
Bring it here, will you?
Paradise sets the tray down and hands a piece of paper to Inspector Fife.
I found this in Sir Lionel's room behind the dresser, sir. Might be important.
Thank you.
Your hat, sir?
Thank you so much.
Charlie, my cable and this letter proves that your dancer was telling the truth.
I think so.
Sir Lionel was looking for an Englishman named Alan Raleigh.
This butler, Paradise, also English, and also have opportunity to handle mail. Look at that date on the postmark on the envelope.
You're right, Charlie. The letter was stolen from this envelope. Quickly, see if you can find a thumbprint on this tray.
Look, here on the tray, a good print.
And the other print? Let's see them side by side.
Identical.
Positive?
Could not be mistaken.
Oh, it seems impossible we've blindly stumbled on the solution of this crime.
The impossible sometimes permits itself the luxury of occurring.
I think I'll take this man in charge.
No, wait. We can watch. Do not wave stick when trying to catch dog. I'm sorry this happened.
Why?
It adds more water to an ocean of puzzlement. John R. Douglas, Alan Raleigh, Lee Gung, Enderby, and now Paradise. Innocent and guilty in this case are harder to separate than Siamese twins.
In Shirley Marlowe's dressing room at the Follies, the actress writes a letter.
Dear Mr. Chan, may I see you at once? I have decided to tell the police everything. Tanya, is my car outside?
I don't know. Shall I go and see it, mademoiselle?
No. Never mind. I'm going to tell the police everything, Tanya. Tell the chauffeur to deliver this at once. The gentleman may come back with him.
Oui, mademoiselle. Chauffeur!
Yes, ma'am.
Mademoiselle wants you to deliver this at once. A gentleman may come back with you. And hurry.
Okay, honey.
As the chauffeur drives, he suddenly feels dizzy. His throat constricts. His eyes lose focus. As he tries to hold the car steady, he remains unaware that just before he entered his car, a shadowy figure shattered a vial of poisonous gas on the floorboards in the back seat.
Hey, watch out! Hey,
look out! Wake up!
Oh, jeez.
Get an ambulance here quickly.
Officer, did you see what happened?
Everyone stand back. This fella's dead. Get back there. All get back. Get back.
Did you see it? Did you see what happened?
No, I was down the street. I wasn't around. I was kind of...
Hey, Sully, come here. Look at this.
Oh, what do you make of it?
I don't think the crash killed him. You better phone the inspector.
As the police officers look at the broken glass of the vial, a man in a chauffeur's uniform walks up.
Hey, excuse me, officers. A terrible tragedy, but I'm afraid I need to take this car back to its owner.
You know who this car belongs to?
It belongs to the masked dancer at the Follies. Her name's Marlo. She's over at the theater now.
Guess we'll go and see that dancer. I'll phone the inspector from the theater.
Okay, come on. Get back, folks. Get back. There's nothing for you to see here. Now get back.
Shirley Marlowe prepares for her show, hoping for the arrival of Charlie Chan.
Give me my robe, Tanya. See who it is.
Come in, officer.
I have some bad news for you, miss. Your chauffeur's just been murdered.
Murdered? How?
Looks like poison gas.
It was meant for me.
Did you write this letter?
Yes. You'd better open it.
What was all this you were going to tell the police? Guess you'd better come down to headquarters. I'll be waiting for you outside.
Back at police headquarters a short time later, Shirley Marlowe meets with Inspector Flannery and Charlie Chan.
This is just as I told it to you, Mr. Chan, and there's nothing I can add to it.
Would you recognize this Alan Raleigh? Now, would you?
I think so, Inspector Flannery, but he may have changed.
We may have him here this afternoon.
After what happened last night, you must be convinced that Mr. Douglas is innocent.
There's one thing we're sure of. It wasn't Douglas who killed your chauffeur. Now, Miss Marlowe, I'll kindly ask you to wait in the next office. I'll tell you something, Chan. That one is shielding Raleigh. Send Douglas in here.
With that, John Douglas is collected from his cell and brought to Inspector Flannery's office.
Thank you, officer. Sit down, Douglas. Well, we finally found out why you won't talk.
Have you?
Yes. Do you know a girl named Shirley Marlowe?
No. No, I don't know anyone of that name.
Think again, Douglas. She's known as the masked dancer of the Follies.
Sorry, I don't know her.
Don't happen to be engaged to marry her, huh?
Hardly, since I've never heard of her.
Did you know someone tried to kill her last night?
What?
Well, I thought you didn't know her. Will you ask her to come in, Charlie?
Certainly. Will you come in, please?
Never saw this girl before, eh?
No.
John, it's no use. I've told them everything.
Oh, Shirley. Why did you?
Because I want them to know that you're innocent, darling.
Douglas, we know why you called on Sir Lionel. Will you answer just one question?
If I can.
Did you see anyone in the office or the building?
Yes.
Who?
As I was waiting for the elevator, I saw a Chinaman with a basket on his arm start to walk up the stairs.
Perhaps Li Gong.
I think I'll leave Li Gong to you, Charlie.
Thank you. You give me an easy job.
We're taking up the matter of bail for you with the district attorney.
Thanks. Shirley, I owe this to you, dear. Be careful. We can't have anything happen to you.
I'm taking care of that. I've assigned a detective. John, will you wait in the other office?
Sorry to bother you. Inspector Fife is here.
Send him in. Well, Inspector, where is Enderby?
Is this young woman Miss Marlowe?
Yes.
Well, I'm sorry. We can't have Enderby here to meet her.
Why?
He left town last night.
What?
No one seems to know where he's gone or when he'll be back. But we'll find him.
Miss Marlowe, you can go. For now. I'll have to ask you to come back again.
Pardon, Inspector, aren't you overlooking something?
What?
This young woman is wanted by Scotland Yard.
Flannery speaking. What's that? A tugboat, you say? What's the name of it? The OK. That's novel. 70th Street? No. I'll attend it to myself. Miss Marlowe, will you wait in the other office, please? Gentlemen, a gas mask has been found in the East River. I'll order a police boat to find the tug that picked it up. Have a boat ready for me at 9 o'clock.
Inspector Flannery, Inspector Fife, and Charlie Chan race to the docks to look at the latest clue to the mysterious gas murders.
How are you, Inspector Flannery?
Hello, Mike. We're looking for a tugboat called the OK. Usually ties up around 70th Street, East River. Make it snappy.
Yeah, right, sir.
Advertising for gas mask, better idea than I thought.
I only hope it proves to be the right one, Charlie.
The man said he was standing on the pier and saw the tugboat. Okay, pick it up. If you can find it, it might lead to something.
If not, it may be a long time before the beginning and ending of this case shake hands.
Cheer up, Charlie. The big town isn't getting you, is it?
No, but I'm very lonesome for my new son in Honolulu.
How many children have you, Charlie? 12, isn't it?
No, 11.
Only 11.
What are you trying to do, Charlie? Raise enough voters to elect yourself sheriff of Honolulu?
I never thought of that, but sounds like a good idea.
Was the boy born in a hospital?
Oh, no. Homemade.
There's the tug, Charlie. You okay? Hey, you! You! Come out of here!
Yeah, what do you want?
Are you the owner of this boat?
Nah, listen, see, you're making a mistake. You got the wrong guy. I wasn't there, I don't know nothing about it. I got 6 witnesses can prove I was in Donovan's when it happened.
When what happened?
I don't know.
What do you mean you don't know?
Well, I thought you was accusing me of something.
Where's the mask you picked up in the river?
That's what you want?
Yeah.
Well, why didn't you say so? I got it right here. There it is.
Where'd you pick it up?
Right off the 96th Street Pier.
When?
Early last Tuesday.
That was day after murder.
Yes, and here's the number. I'll find out who sold this and maybe who bought it.
Hey, listen, there ought to be something coming to me for this, hadn't there?
If you ever get what's coming to you, it'll probably be 20 years.
So, swell, don't I even get a new hat out of this?
Good head always gets own new hat.
In an apartment, Lee Gung prepares for a fateful meeting.
Sure, I am too busy to pet you.
Lee Gung positions a chair carefully, then takes a Colt 45 pistol and sets it beside a fishbowl on a nearby table. Using books to hold the gun steady, Lee Gung carefully aims it exactly at the chair. Lee Gung raises a window shade, and sun streams in on the table with the gun and the fishbowl. The bowl casts a pinpoint of light, like a magnifying glass. Gung positions the gun so that the light strikes the hammer. Gung carefully cocks the gun. Now the sun's light sits focused precisely on the cartridge. With everything precisely set, Gung takes a framed picture and sets it in front of the tableau, obscuring it from view. He then lowers the shade.
Homa!
Homa! You are on time. I am expecting visitor whom I cannot trust.
Police!
I need you for witnesses. Come.
I wonder what he wants.
He will tell us.
Uncle, here's Mr. Chan.
Oh, hello.
Hello. Big scout very full of rice. He find me.
Please, be seated.
Lee Gung motions Charlie Chan to sit in the very chair he has so carefully arranged.
Thank you.
Oh, I have business to talk.
I have no place to go.
Go, do good deed.
You have news of Lee Gung?
Yes. I invite my friends Po Ki and Lu Tom to join us. They also friends of Lee Gong.
Really?
Let's have light.
Lee Gong steps to the window and raises the shade, while Charlie Chan watches with suspicion on his face.
The rays of the sun accomplish many desirable things in this world.
Where is Lee Gong?
Patience. I have prepared startling surprise for you.
I shall be most happy to receive it. That picture on the table, the one of my old friend Lee Gung, you moved it. Hard to see with bright sunlight behind it.
That is not Lee Gung.
No? A long time since I've seen him.
You see him now. I am Lee Gung. What do you want?
As Charlie Chan studies Lee Gung, he remains unaware of the hot, focused sunbeam beginning to heat the bullet cartridge in the carefully positioned gun. A tiny wisp of smoke rises from the primer.
I must be sure that you are Lee Gung.
You want to know about Alan Raleigh?
Where is he?
In New York. I saw him recently.
Perhaps at the death of Sir Lionel Gray.
Get off there, cat! Sorry for distraction. You wish to know who killed Sir Lionel?
That would favor me too much.
I shall tell you all.
Go on.
But you will never use this information.
Why not?
Because dead men tell no secrets.
As Li Gong speaks these words, the heat from the sun's focused rays raises the temperature of the bullet casing to the flash point for gunpowder.
Li Gong!
What happened? It was supposed to be you!
What has happened to Li Gong?
He has been shot!
Cat move gun behind picture. Curiosity kill not cat, but would-be killer.
Let me in here. What's going on here?
I am Inspector Chan of Honolulu Police. This man tried to commit murder, but made slight mistake in subject.
Very well, Mr. Chan. I know where I can find you.
Later, at police headquarters, a bespectacled clerk examines the gas mask brought in by Charlie Chan as Inspector Flannery watches carefully.
Well, let me see here. What's this? Oh, it's one of our gas masks. Yes, sir, absolutely. That is the mask I sold.
How many of these have you sold in the last week?
No, just that one.
You couldn't be mistaken about who bought it.
No, absolutely not. It was a Chinaman.
Are you sure you'd recognize this Chinaman if you saw him again?
Oh, absolutely, but I never forget a face.
Charlie Chan, good to see you. This is the man who sold the gas mask. He's going to help us identify the murderer by telling us who bought it.
What? No, I don't understand. That's the man. Well, he's wearing different clothes, but I'd know him anywhere.
What?
No, absolutely. That's the man I sold the gas mask to.
I bought this gas mask.
Oh, yes, you did.
Humbly ask how many fingers I hold up.
One. Just the one.
Blind as a bat, Charlie.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, we'll call you when we want you again. Send this gentleman home, officer. So, what do you think about this, Charlie?
Well, I'm surprised to find out I myself, man, I was looking for.
Well, I'm afraid you are right. Li Gong is the man we want. I'll find him if I have to comb this whole town.
Too late.
Why's that?
Even now, Li Gong is preparing to attend his own unworthy funeral.
You don't mean that he's...
dead. Dead as sardine in honorable tin can. He invited me into trap, but caught wrong fox.
Did you kill him, Charlie?
No. He saved me trouble by politely killing himself.
Oh, did you find out anything?
Only that Alan Raleigh is in New York.
Yes, and Enderby is still missing. I wonder if Fife could be right about him.
I don't know. Sometimes hope becomes scarce as midnight rainbow.
Yes, and our only arrest is out on bail. Charlie, we're on the spot. Even now, the New York and London papers are after us.
My stupidity overwhelms me. Perhaps all I've accomplished is to send unhappy girl back to England.
Yes, yes, and that's where Fife will take her, unless we find Raleigh.
I've only one miserable hope left.
What's that?
Could you introduce me to a cosmopolitan club?
Sure, I can make the arrangements, but there's nothing there, Charlie. I think we're all wet.
But man is not incurably drowned if he still knows he is all wet.
That evening, at the gathering place of New York Society, the Cosmopolitan Club, the manager and Charlie Chan stand together in the lobby.
Certainly, Inspector. Right over here. Let me introduce you to our cloakroom clerk. Joe, give this gentleman any information he wishes.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much. Found this card. It has number on back. Do check numbers run as high as 1313?
Let me see. Yes, sir.
Something is checked on that number now?
Yes. A briefcase.
May I examine it?
Very well.
Does that belong to some Chinese gentleman?
Why do you ask?
Chinaman came here a few days ago trying to get it. We wouldn't give it to him because he wouldn't tell us who sent it.
If you will allow me, please.
Certainly. Anything important?
Are names of all members in this membership book I have?
Yes, alphabetically.
You have new applications?
Yes, right here. They are posted on this board. Look here.
That one.
A guest card was sent to him last night.
Is he in club now?
No, but he received this card this morning. He may be here any minute.
May I use telephone?
Certainly.
Hello? Spring 73100. Inspector Flannery, please. Quickly. Charlie Chan.
In a few minutes, the call from Charlie Chan is answered by the arrival of Inspector Flannery, who joins him in the lobby of the Cosmopolitan Club.
Well, has he come yet?
Not yet. If he calls for the briefcase, we can see.
Are you sure it's Sir Lionel's briefcase?
Yes. It was checked here soon after the murder.
By whom?
Wait and see.
Mr. Garrick Enderby! Paging Mr. Garrick Enderby!
Do you think he'll put up a fight, Charlie?
Don't know. Got gun?
No. Have you?
Got gun, but...
Well, Fife will have the Marlowe girl at Kirk's. She'll identify him. Let's keep it down while this group passes.
Barry Kirk's group, you mean?
That is Kirk, isn't it? Here, let's back up out of sight.
Joe, my coat, please.
Mine too, if you will. Here's the ticket.
Well, up to that time, Kirk, you'd led a virtuous life, I suppose.
Well, you're not suggesting it's not been that way all along. After all, you're not ruining my reputation.
Well, are you coming our way, Barry?
No, thanks. I'm going downtown.
Well, so long.
So long.
Good night, all.
I almost forgot this.
Yes, Mr. Kirk.
I left my briefcase here the other night. The number's 1313.
Here you are, sir.
Thanks, Joe.
Hello.
Oh, Charlie Chan. How are you?
Joe, my hat and coat, please. Is that your briefcase?
No. It belongs to a friend of mine.
Oh, really?
Yes, Inspector Flannery. He left it here at noon. He asked me to stop for it.
Well, where were you taking it, Kirk?
Home.
Perhaps a good idea we all go home.
Yes, of course. Come along.
Back at the apartment of Barry Kirk, Shirley Marlowe, John Douglas, and Inspector Fife enter through the front door.
I won't detain you here long, Miss Marlowe. A man will be here in a moment whom I'd like you to take a good look at. I'll ring for the butler. Just a moment, please.
Did you ring, sir?
Yes, Paradise, I did. There's someone I want you to meet. Miss Marlowe, have you ever seen this man before?
No, I haven't.
Are you quite sure?
Yes.
I see. Mr. Marlowe, Miss Douglas, would you mind stepping out into the garden?
Of course not.
Thank you. Come here, Paradise. Why did you steal that letter from Sir Lionel's mail?
I didn't, sir.
Now, don't lie. We found your thumbprint on a blank sheet of paper in the Scotland Yard envelope.
I was absolutely innocent of the charge, sir.
I know. You were acquitted. The Yard informed me. But you were afraid of Sir Lionel.
When I saw that letter was from Scotland Yard, I thought it was about me. And I was panic-stricken, sir. Oh, please, sir. You're not going to tell Mr. Kirk.
Perhaps you'd better see who that is, Paradise.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Enderby! Excuse me! Well, Inspector Fife, you sent for me. Here I am.
Yeah, so I see, Mr. Enderby.
Well, now I'm here. What do you want of me? Can't a man take a little jaunt without the police asking questions? If I'm guilty of anything, arrest me and I'll answer your questions in court.
Just a moment. Miss Marlowe, Mr. Douglas.
Miss Marlowe, Mr. Douglas? What's it all about? What's it about?
Miss Marlowe, do you recognize this man?
No.
Are you quite sure he's not Alan Raleigh?
Of course. I've never seen him before.
Is that why you brought me here?
I'm sorry. I hope we haven't inconvenienced you.
Sorry? Bah! Bringing me here on a fool's errand? Inspector?
Yes, Mr. Douglas.
Isn't it possible that if the British Home Secretary knew the facts of this case, that he would waive extradition?
I doubt it.
But if he knew that Miss Marlowe was not guilty of this crime, that she merely shielded a man through a human forgivable impulse...
Mr. Douglas, I'm afraid I simply cannot predict what the Home Secretary would do. Ah, good evening, Charlie. Inspector Flannery. Mr. Kirk?
Miss Marlowe. You have never seen Mr. Kirk before?
Why, yes.
Oh? Where?
I don't know.
What do you mean, Miss Marlowe? You said that every...
Just one moment. Wish to speak privately, if you do not mind, please. Inspectors, we go to garden patio. Mr. Kirk, the briefcase.
Sir Lionel's briefcase? Where did you get it?
We are indebted to Mr. Kirk.
We'd better have a look at the contents.
Yes.
Fife, wait. I have an idea. Let's go back inside. Mr. Kirk, will you open that door and pretend you're alone?
Why, yes.
You leave the briefcase here, and you two go in there, will you please?
See wisdom of plan. Inspector Fife, follow, please.
If you say so, Charlie. But I'm not much for hiding behind doors.
Hello, Barry. Are you alone?
Come in, Dunwood. How are you?
Oh, I've had a busy day. Oh, I see you got my case for me. Thanks.
When did you get your membership card?
This morning. I lunched at the club and forgot my case. Why do you ask?
Look here, Dunwood. You wouldn't cast suspicion on an old friend, would you? I was told you hadn't been to the club today.
Well, you've been misinformed. And now, if you'll excuse me, I'll...
If you'll excuse me...
What? Inspector!
What are you doing with Sir Lionel Gray's papers?
Oh, there's been a frightful mistake.
Yes, that mistake was when you and your assistant Lee Goon killed Sir Lionel Gray. You dangerous man. That is why you excuse me pointing gun at you. Man capable of murder may try desperate action.
Yes, and another mistake you made was trying to murder the masked dancer.
Miss Marlowe and Mr. Douglas, will you come in, please? Do you know this man?
Oh, Alan Raleigh.
I deny everything. I never saw this woman before. She never saw me.
You deny? Oh, wait a minute. Something bothering Nose.
Inspector Chan, are you all right?
Can't stop sneezing.
The gun!
He dropped it.
I'll take that.
Watch out, he's got the gun!
Keep back! Thanks, Mr. Chan. Nice gun. It's warmed up for me. I am Alan Raleigh. I did kill Sir Lionel. It was his life or mine. You may keep the briefcase. I don't need it. I'm leaving. Now get over there.
Sorry, but no. You are more important than briefcase.
I'll shoot!
I think not. I walk and take gun away like parent take toy from sleeping child.
Look out, Charlie! Look out, it'll kill you!
Charlie!
Hey, Mr. Chan!
You made me do this! The gun! There's no bullets!
Grab him! I got it! Hold on there!
That's it! That's it! Got him! I got him! All right!
Old habit, Mr. Raleigh. Wife never likes loaded gun on account of children.
Clever trick, Charlie. Now we've got his confession.
Yes, you've got it.
Overlook the essential clue. 1313. Doubly bad luck.
After the police have taken away Alan Raleigh, also known as Kenneth Dunwood, Shirley and John embrace on the rooftop patio, unaware that they are watched by the friendly eyes of Charlie Chan, Inspector Fife, and Inspector Flannery.
Shirley, I'll be by your side.
Hate to admit, but power of true love often stronger than law.
But for you, Charlie, you put off seeing your own baby to help us.
This case bittersweet. Think whirlwind of love not served here by whirlwind of justice. I could be happy man if I had not been the cause of this young lady's return to England.
Well, under the circumstances, Scotland Yard will call the case against Miss Marlowe closed, of course.
Surely that means you don't have to go back.
Are you serious? Oh my, thank you, Inspector Fife.
No, don't thank me. Thank Charlie Chan.
Charlie, thank you.
Yes, thank you. Thank you.
Oh, bring me great joy to see happy couple ready to build nest.
Well, Charlie, I guess the honor goes to you.
Ah, no. The geese who laid the eggs deserve the credit. The honor goes to you, Inspector Flannery, and to you, Inspector Fife.